Figural mosaics. They are characterized by a special selection of subjects, type of composition, and use of the plan. Moreover, their narration creates continuous lightning stories, which are known, for example, from mythology or even private life of Roman nobility. Such mosaics were displayed either in the context of public buildings, such as amphitheaters, or private estates of influential landlords. The aim of this paper is to analyze the representation of jewelry on these mosaics and comparing them to artifacts found in the area of Roman Empire or to the other representation in Roman iconography. In total, I collected 12 mosaics with 20 mosaics, sorry, with 25 scenes with depictions of owners of estates and their wives. The representation of jewelry are visible only on 3 of them, but on 4 scenes. These works of art were discovered mostly in the province Africa Proconsularis, in present territory of Tunisia. There are many problems with identification of images of different people with landlords or their wives, but in my opinion it's easier to determine that when we look not only at specific poles and the context of such people, but also at clothes or jewelry which these people have. Among all representations of landlords, only one has got a jewelry. This depiction comes from mosaic from city Rif in Tunisia, and it dates at the end of 4th or at the beginning of 5th century AD. And this mosaic was found in one of the vestibula in Roman private bathhouse. It shows scene with 3 people. 2 of them have got rich ornamented clothes, and they are here. What indicates their high position in Roman Africa in society, and what's interesting and important for my presentation, the man on the right side has got a necklace. It is round and in silver color, and in my opinion, it is probably some kind of cork. As we know, this kind of jewelry was introduced from nations which surrounding the Roman Empire, particularly the Persians or Sassanids and the Goths. There are numerous artifacts which illustrate the cork. The Romans were aware that the Persians wore the cork in the celebrated mosaic from of the Battle of Issus, Alexander fighting Darius, which member of his retinue are represented were the Turk. The Romans were also aware that the Gauls who wore the Turk, as is evident from the equally celebrated statue of the dying Gaul. How the Turk came into favor in late Roman and early Byzantine society is a little obscure. According to researchers, torques were used in the Roman army to reward valorous officers. However, it is unlikely that the torque was restricted to being a reward for valor in the 4th and 5th century. It would also have been worn as a personal ornament, just as a necklace. But in my opinion, it would emphasize the high position of its owner, as we can see that's on the mosaic from Sidi. The jewelry is an important element which complements women's clothing. It is not only emphasize the affluence, but also determine the affiliation to social groups, or it gives individuality to the people who it wear. What's more, jewelry was particularly important to women because it was considered to be their own property, which could be kept independently of their husband's wealth and used as the women sold. Unfortunately, there aren't many examples of jewelry which is dated just as mosaics with representation of landlords' wives. And what's worse, the artifacts which remain are preserved haven't been well studied or they just disappeared. All mosaics with representation of jewelry or by landlords' wives are there. Are they similar to mentioned above mosaic from Sigrid? And we know that in this time jewelry was characterized by splendor, and the most popular were bracelets and necklaces, which is what is also visible on the mosaics. First representation comes from non-mosaic of Dominus Iulius from Carthage. And the scene is in the middle of upper register. And there's a lady who is sitting on a bench in the shade of cypresses, and she's finding herself. She has brought two gold bracelets, one on each wrist. They are simple without any ornaments, made probably from one piece of metal. And such bracelets were very popular in the Roman Empire. The other representation is in the lower register on the left side. The lady of the estate is in the center of the composition. She is leaning on a column and looking at herself in a little mirror, which is folded in her left hand. On her left side, there's a woman with a little white box, probably made of ivory with jewelry or cosmetics. On the lower part we can see the remains of the depiction of a person with three fishes. On the right side of the lady there's a man with a basket full of roses. And the lady wears almost transparent clothes, which accentuates her figure. She has got more jewelry than on the previous representation. She wears a necklace, probably gold, with a dark green-like pendant. She has got also earrings, with, which are similar to the pendant. There's a white bandage with pearls on her hair. And also the woman who waits on her is passing her a beads necklace, which is joined by a string or thong. And this kind of necklace was popular in the Roman Empire over the years. And here we have got examples, two examples of necklaces from Roman Africa, which are similar to these shown on Dominus Iulius mosaic. One with a dark green pendant and second with beads. The last important element on this scene is a little box for jewelry, which is here, which is called pyxis. They were originally mostly used by women to hold cosmetics, trinkets, such as, for example, the pins or for jewelry. Surviving pyxides are mostly Greek pottery, but especially in later periods, maybe in wood, metal, ivory, or other materials. And the representation of pyxides are known from classical Greek grave-steles, and even in Dom's time they were used, for example, for emphasize the status symbols. And the best example is the grave-stele of Hegeso. It is renovated as one of the finest Attic graves. Steles surviving mostly intact today. It is dated for 5th century BC. The main shows a mature Athenian woman who is sitting on a chair. In her left hand, she's holding an open pyxis. And in her right, she's holding a piece of missing jewelry. And the best known iconographical example of pyxis comes from ancient Cuma in Italy. And this object is made from wood and ivory with some gold elements. The last scene with representation of landlord's white jewelry comes from Sid Grip. This mosaic was found in the same Roman private bathhouse as the first one, but in other vestibule. The lady is sitting in the center of this scene. She's trying on an earring or dressing her hair. She is presented in bigger proportions than her two servants who are standing on both her sides. One of these women is holding a mirror and the second one a case, probably with jewelry. The lady is wearing a long to colored tunic without sleeves. Moreover, she has got five bracelets, earrings and a necklace. Her Venus-like pose, clothes, people and objects that surround her indicate her high position. She has got very similar bracelets to the Dominus Julius wives on the first scene, as we remember. There are simple rounded ornaments made probably from one piece of metal. On her neck there is a necklace made with several rows of pearls, and in her ears and the ears of her servant who is standing on her left side, there are earrings which are in example of lady gold, and in servant's ears they are silver. It is important that earrings dated on the same period as the mosaic could be decorated with granulation or filigree, but unfortunately jewelry on this mosaic is so small that it's really hard to determine if it was ornaments or not. However, it is certain that in this time women carried earrings in pierced ears. Among the artefacts from Roman Empire, we can find some earrings which are similar to these worn by lady from Sidi and her servant. First pair of them, each with a shield framed by twisted wire, centered by a large granule, and with a red and purple beads. Second, with a square and mint green glass face with hanging bead. The woman who is on the lady's left side wore a round necklace with two swellings on it. It could be a torque or other chocolate-style necklace. It is probably silver, but I found only analogies for it among gold jewelry. First, from the treasure from today, Ostromace in northeastern Slovakia, late on the 3rd century AD. And second, from an encaustic portrait represented a woman from Antinopolis in Egypt, dated on the 2nd or 3rd century AD. As I have said, this scene from Sidi Grip is similar to a representation of Venus. And the best analogy from Roman North Africa comes from a mosaic from Elgin in Tunisia. Venus is represented in the middle of this masterpiece. She is surrounded by two cupids, one with a mirror and some kind of wreath, and the second with some of her ornaments. This goddess has got probably a gold necklace with a dark oval pendant, and in my opinion it is similar to this work by our Dominus Julius wife of the second scene. The representation of jewelry on Roman African mosaics not only show us how jewelry looked in 4th and 5th century AD, but also how they play a special symbolic role. Thanks to them, it is possible to notice the clear relationship between forms of dress and the position within social order. the jewellery shown on the present as mosaic has got some analogies among artefacts from the Roman Empire, but generally from precedent centuries. Sometimes those traditions of similarity reach way farther back in time than the existence of the Roman Empire. For example, the representation of pyxides, which are known status symbols already on classical Greek grave-steles. What's important, we can look at representations of jewellery on Roman African mosaics, thanks to good quality of these works of art. What also emphasizes the richness of landlords and their wives who could afford them. And thank you for your attention.